Hi everyone, I'm Philippe von Flop, and I'm coming to you live from Ireland. Slip inside the eye of your mind. Don't you know you might find a better place to play? You said yet you'd never been, but all the things that you've seen will slowly fade away. So I start a revolution from my head, 'cause you said the brains that I had went to my head. Step outside, the summertime's in bloom. Stand up beside the fireplace, take that look from off your face, 'cause you ain't ever gonna burn my heart out. So Sally can wait, she knows it's too late as we're walking on by. Her soul slides away, but don't look back in anger, I heard you say. And so Sally can wait, she knows it's too late as we're walking on by. Her soul slides away, but don't look back in anger. Don't look back in anger, I heard you say. Hey guys, I'm very glad to be with you here all today. I'm very glad to be part of this with you. Although these are testing times and it's not business as usual for anyone, startups have got it particularly hard. However, something like this forces us to pause, regroup, and innovate. No room, no time for anger. Let's rise up. I hope this webinar helps you all to do so. And on that note, I'll pass you over to Natalia from the Dubai World Trade Center. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Philippe, for the great performance, and thank you for kicking us off today. Hello to all. I'm Natalia Kayla, conference producer for Jitec's Future Stars, which is the biggest and fastest growing startup event in the Middle East, North Africa, and South Asia. Although we can't wait to high-five you all in person later this year at the live show, and while we wait for things to get back to normal, albeit a new normal, we've created our virtual series as we look to extend global conversations and continue to support the startup community. Today marks the first webinar in this series, and on behalf of Dubai World Trade Center and the entire of Jitec's Future Stars team, we are delighted to welcome you all. With that in mind, I'm super keen to get started and excited to pass you over to someone I'm sure needs no introduction in the tech space, Josh Constein, former editor-at-large for TechCrunch US and currently principal investor and head of content for Signalfire. Over to you, Josh.
Thank you so much, Natalia. The startup ecosystem is experiencing an unprecedented challenge due to COVID-19, since these young companies often only have enough funding to survive for a few months without revenue. Given the economic disruption of the pandemic, U.S. startups have already suffered over 34,000 layoffs. That means local governments and financial institutions must step up to ensure the startup ecosystem perseveres and innovation continues. Luckily, today we have an incredible group of panelists who will share their thoughts on how governments can support the startup communities, how founders can keep their businesses alive, and what products we hope to see startups build to aid this crisis. Now, I'd like to introduce our panelists. First, please welcome His Excellency, Dr. Tariq Benhendi.
Good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. My name is Tariq, and I'm the Director General of the Abu Dhabi Investment Office, tasked with helping the private sector succeed in Abu Dhabi.
Thank you. Please welcome Thomas Jarosz-Zombek.
Everybody, and good morning to Dubai and wherever in the world. So I'm very pleased to be here with you. I'm the German Commissioner for Startups and Digital Business in the Ministry for Economic Affairs in Germany.
Thank you. Please welcome Kat Borlangen.
Bonjour, my name is Kat Berlangen, and I lead a very special team inside the Macron administration. It's called the French Tech Mission, and our job is to make sure that French government is the best possible partner for its growing startup ecosystem.
Thank you. Please welcome Martin Pitchinson.
Hello, everyone. How are you doing? This is Martin Pitchinson from Silicon Valley. I'm the co-founder of Sherwood Partners. We're the gold standard to the venture capital community when problems arise, or sadly, when they need to be shut down.
Thank you. And please welcome Viknesh R. Pillai.
Hi, everybody. I'm Viknesh. I'm one of the co-founders and managing partners of TMB Aura, one of Singapore government's approved co-investment partners, and we invest into early stage startups in Southeast Asia.
Wonderful. And for a little context on myself, I'm Josh Constein. I was formerly the editor-at-large for TechCrunch, where I spent over 8.5 years writing over 4,000 articles about startups. And most recently, I joined SignalFire, a venture capital fund, to look at early-stage startups across the spectrum. And I'd like to really thank so many of the incredible attendees who are joining us from around the world, including Dr. Peters from Nigeria and Abdullah Sami from Iraq. Now, I'd like to get into our first big question, which is to ask, what is it that local institutions in each of your countries have been doing to ensure that startups survive through this crisis? His Excellency, would you like to start us off?
Yeah, thanks, Josh. I think that's it's a great question. I think that we have to look at that within the context of what has been happening in the short term versus what all these countries and economies are trying to achieve over the long term. And I think it's been really fascinating to be involved in this and to be, going through the experience that we're going now. Next slide, please. I think that one thing that really stands out is that Abu Dhabi has always had a very long-term ambition as it relates to supporting the venture capital as well as the startup ecosystem. And we have a really strong focus on SMEs. And we're going to, just for the sake of this, bucket the startups into that SME and micro SME group. And I think one thing that's really come out over the last few months is that Abu Dhabi was very quick in announcing all these various economic stimulus packages as well as financial initiatives to support the startup and SME space. And a lot of the information can be found on the government portals, on social media, as well as their website. Can you please move to the next slide? One thing that I did want to highlight is that from an Abu Dhabi perspective, it's a very business-friendly environment, a lot of innovation being created and looking for those startups that are going to be able to come in and help us innovate. And we were set up as the Abu Dhabi Investment Office to help facilitate that as part of our mandate. And I think it's really critical to emphasize this point is that we really want feedback from the startups so that we can make sure that these programs are robust and that we're helping them in the short term, as well as over the long term of their existence. So thank you.
Marvelous. Thomas, would you like to give us some of your insights on your local response?
Yes, so thanks for the opportunity to explain what we are doing in Germany. At first, I have to say that we are supporting the startup ecosystem for several years right now. In the meantime, we made a co-investment of 4 billion euros. So the standard strategy which we are rolling out is that we can invest into funds as an LP, and therefore we can make a share of 20-40% in these funds. And we invested 4 billion euros over these years. For 2 years now, since the new minister, Peter Altmaier, is in office, we are doubling that investment to 8 billion euros. But now we are facing the situation of Corona and COVID-19. And as you already said, Josh, we are a lot of startups are facing the problem of this Corona crisis. And therefore, we're just starting an additional 2 billion euro fund. And this 2 billion euro fund consists of two pillars. The first pillar goes to the larger startups that have a venture capitalist on board. And so we can invest as an LP into their facilities for helping these Corona crisis startups with up to 70%. And the second pillar is for the more smaller startups, and therefore we can help them with up to 800,000 euro in grants. And so this is what we are doing here right now. And we are also discussing what to do for the recovery time once we are over this crisis. And therefore, we want to invest a further 10 billion euros in a thing we call a future fund that has several modules. One of them is to invest especially in deep tech with an investment perspective of 10 to 20 years. And we have also some additional models on that. So that in the end, we are heading for the end of the year to have a total amount of 20 billion euros of co-investment. So everybody going to invest in Germany is very much invited. We have very strong startup hubs like Berlin or like Munich and also other places where you can meet a lot of very interesting funders.
Great, thank you so much for that. Next, I'd love to hear from Kat. Would you be able to tell us about the French response?
Yeah, sure. Thanks so much, Josh. So France, France launched a pretty general economic support plan for all companies. This includes startups, of course. Some highlights are the 300 billion liquidity support, which allows to back loans, the measures that allow companies to skip tax payments, rent, and utility bills. And the most important, which is used by more than half of the tech ecosystem in France today, is the furlough scheme, where companies can put their employees on what we call chômage partiel, and government covers up to 84 to 100% of their salaries. But for startups, we need to go the extra mile. France was the first country to announce a startup emergency plan, not because we had necessarily the most cash on hand, but because it was such a no-brainer. We really believe in the future of tech entrepreneurship, and we want to stick with our ecosystem in sickness and in health, for richer or poorer, and we're there for them. So the measures break down into four different chunks. The first one was that we automatically created what we call the French Tech Bridge, which is the bridge fund. Some VCs reneged or pulled out on term sheets. I mean, this happened in all of your countries, others backed down. So we immediately put 80 million on the table in match funding to be able to support the bridge rounds that were happening at that time. Sort of like coronavirus measures aside, France is actually one of Europe's most active investors, like the French government, both at the seed and the growth stage. So to give you an idea, if you know a little bit about the European tech investment landscape, we're roughly at par with Balderton and ID Invest in terms of number of investments per year. We have startup specific funds totaling over 1.3 billion a year, and not counting like roughly 7 billion in R&D tax credits and another 10 billion in general innovation funding. This is yearly. Now we put in a special track for startups for state-backed loans. This was kind of a pain for a lot of companies. Startups can borrow as much as 2 years of payroll for their employees based in France, or 25% of annual revenue, whichever is higher. This is super important because, unlike a lot of SMEs, startups aren't necessarily, cash positive or have any revenue for quite a while. So this should represent roughly 2.2 billion. And then third, startups get tax returns pretty quickly. This is to inject more liquidity into the ecosystem. Particularly VAT and also R&D tax credits. So, and then, last but not the least, the state does quite a lot of specific grants and other forms of startup funding, and we just accelerated payments for the last mile, which is 250 million.
Great, thank you so much for that information. Martin, would you be able to tell us a little bit about the Silicon Valley and the United States' response?
Well, in the Silicon Valley, we're seeing a huge change in the VC's attitude. Basically, I'm probably the guy here on this conference that went through the dot-com era. I'm the guy that closed down most of the dot-coms. And so what we're seeing now really are the VCs are making faster decisions. They want to see exactly who to invest in and who they're going to have to sadly let go. There's deep consideration by all the VCs, and there's no reconsideration. We're getting calls on a daily basis. Our telephone calls are three times what they've been historically, and we're getting two to three VC closings almost a week, and we're seeing it really starting to go towards five or six. I'm on the calls probably from 7 a.m. till 8 p.m. Distressed sales are very strong, but the buyers are very tough. We're in a deal right now that there was a $300 million offer to buy the company. It's being sold now for $30 million. M&A firms are using us, and there's more IP being sold, and we sell a tremendous amount of IP. So we're seeing both distressed company sales as well as IP sales. We believe this is going to go on for the next 3 to 5 years, because as I said, I find this is the coming. This is the great unwinding of this particular era. And yes, by the COVID virus, it's being forced, but we're seeing technology move quicker than it's ever been moving before. Investors are looking for the next great thing. There's less expensive to start a company today, so there are more companies. Historically, there were 2,000 companies funded a year. We're now pushing to 2,500. There is money to be invested. So basically, every startup has to extend their runway, reduce burn, because you deliver or funding is ended. Venture is a true class, and I think everyone involved today on this conference is really excited about what they're doing. And I can only say, who better than Sherwood knows what can go wrong? Save your cash. Don't overspend, because there may not be another round.
That's great insight and really helpful for startup founders trying to figure out just how long this crisis is going to last. And finally, Viknesh, would you be able to give us some perspective on your local response?
Thank you so much, panel, for all the input. So let me just give you firstly a little bit of our view of what has changed since pre-COVID-19. So this is an interesting survey, which was done by Tech in Asia, which covered startups from countries from Indonesia to Singapore to Philippines and Vietnam. So if you look on the left, one of the biggest problems with all startups are delayed revenues and the need to bring down net burn, which is also related to delayed revenues. Another one at the bottom you see is cancellation book revenue. So something which is clear, and I'm with Martin on this as well, where save your cash, everyone is seeing revenues drop, net burns increase, your runways reducing. So it is a very testing time right now. One other point which I want to bring about is the last one at the bottom on the left is inability to raise funds. It's very clear right now that every startup has a goal to, or a business plan for 30 months, 24 months, 36 months sometime for your runway to exist and do a fundraise before that. So there's tons of startups who were funded in 2018, 2017, who are all going to be going through this issue because they're planning on fundraising this year, right? So what has the private sector and public sector done here? So if you go to the next slide. So in the next slide, you'll be able to see what the private and public sector is doing. On the private side, of course, you could have dedicated funds. Someone like us, you know, who's coming about, we want to back fundamentally strong companies who are having a cash flow gap right here, because what has happened is a black swan event. As much as you could have planned it and be careful, you know, it is what it is. Everyone is impacted. You have fundraising catch-ups in the community. So in terms of timestamp, everything happened in Feb, March. People just look internal as investors. But from April, the community has started getting together. There's even been, at the bottom, if you see employment support on the private sector, anyone who's let go, there's a group which has been set up where you can take talent from each other just so that you help each other up during these tough times. If you look on the right, you know, it's similar to what Kat has mentioned, what Thomas would mention with regards to some of the government initiatives. Singapore has come up with tons of initiatives to manage cash flow, deepen capabilities, and retain and develop talent. Managing cash flows, yes, they are helping you to defer income tax, to rent, to, for example, they call it the job support scheme, where they subsidize up to 75% of local staff salaries. Deepen capabilities, they are giving subsidies for traditional businesses to adopt new tech, collaborative tools, etc. So tons of stuff which is being done on the private and public sector. And Singapore continues to be, I say, a market leader in Southeast Asia in coming up with some of these initiatives. Thanks, Josh.
Thanks for that. I want to pose a question to the rest of the panel as well. What do you think has been the most effective government program in order to help more startups survive or at least avoid significant headcount cuts? Are there any programs that you found that were especially effective, or maybe ones that you've seen in other countries that you wish your own country might adopt? Thomas, would you like to tell us?
Yes, so we already established an instrument in the financial crisis in 2008, and that's called the German word Kurzarbeitergeld, and that means that the government is taking over the cost for employees up to 67%, And this was in 2008 quite successful. And now we see a lot of other countries adopting especially this mechanism. And now we established that again, so that helps all the startups, but it's not a startup typical program. That's the reason why I didn't explain it before. It works for every business, for small business, for larger companies, and for startups. And so it's very successful, as you can help yourself with the cost of all the employees that are useless, so to say, in that moment, because you want to keep that infrastructure that after the crisis, people can come back to their working places. And the second thing we are also doing is to extend the time for taxes and other things. So I've seen that on the French side. So this is a mechanism we are also doing and handling with to help companies to gain more liquidity. But this is also not a startup topic. We do this for every kind of business.
But that is definitely a temporary solution, one that works perhaps if the crisis lasts for 6 months. But if we do see subsequent infection waves and shelter in place orders need to be reinstated, are these governments going to be able to sustain paying the salaries of employees across the board of companies in their countries? Or is this something that will eventually run out?
Maybe I can speak a little bit on that, and I'm sure Thomas will have something to say as well as government officials. But when we designed the startup plan, post-COVID, and we released it, now they were designed to stop the hemorrhaging. They were designed to make sure, the crisis is so much worse than it should have been given how startups were taking it. So we wanted to make sure that startups just had the time that they needed to get their stuff together, to make sure that they were able to organize their cash and have enough of a runway, and that we weren't suddenly killing startups that had no reason to die, that were actually great companies. Now, what's going to happen, after these measures have been released, is a lot of governments, including ours, including that of Germany's and your own, are going to start asking ourselves, at which point are we hurting the ecosystem more than we're helping it, considering that maybe 90% of all companies, at least in France, don't make it past year 5. So anything that artificially maintains the ecosystem when it should actually be relying on more market mechanisms can be actually hurtful. So something that's a priority for us is to make sure that we're there for companies and the best companies that can pivot, especially for sectors that are hurt so hard and where consumer trends are just changing. And so we know that they're not just going to go back to normal. I'm speaking about tourism, about mobility, and so on. And that we're especially there for the next generation of startups. I know it's a little sad to say, but I'm personally quite excited to see, what the next generation of startups coming out of COVID-19 are going to be like. And so we're definitely, one of our priorities is to make sure that this phase of unemployment that quite a lot of people are going to be undergoing will be a time that is creative, a time that's for learning. So we're going to be investing quite massively in anything that's related to talent development, for example. And of course, the French government is still there and is still reinforcing a lot of the kind of funds that we have to let anybody sort of be able to launch a startup, regardless of what background they come from.
Great. And His Excellency?
Trying to unmute myself. Sorry about that. So I think it's actually the way that I look at that, the question, Josh, is you can kind of break that up into two groups, and Martin highlighted this earlier about the cash burn, right? And I mean, put this in perspective of the fact that the entrepreneurial space is actually quite nascent still in the UAE relative to my peers on this panel. But what we've seen is that you've got the startups where the cash burn is really high because they've come in demand now in terms of the service that they offer. And then you've got the startups where the cash burn is high, and that's because they haven't revisited their models. They haven't pivoted yet, right? And so we're looking at how it is that we can support those startups through different mechanisms. I think the question then that arises from that is, well, how do you put the right programs in place to make sure that you address the core fundamentals that both sets of those companies are facing? But make sure that you help the company that hasn't pivoted the business model yet to actually start pivoting to be able to address some of those cash burn issues and generate revenue, and then support the companies that are growing really quickly because trends are changing and the behavior of consumers is changing. And we have to make sure that we cater to that group as well and really support them as much as we can. It's been quite an interesting experience over the past couple of months. So that's what I wanted to say.
Yeah, I think a lot of people assume that this has hit all startups very negatively, but whether you're talking about remote work or telehealth and biomedicine, there are a lot of startup areas that are actually doing quite well. You know, you're seeing some video chat startups, for instance, seeing 50x increases in users, or Zoom reaching up to 300 million daily sessions. You know, huge explosions in those markets. And rather than just helping startups that maybe are having trouble during this crisis and maybe laying off people, governments also need to ensure that those companies that are succeeding can embrace that growth and provide those same kind of incredible services and products. Because as we found, you know, a lot of these startups are offering what essentially are essential services. They have become public utilities of their own. And it's important that the governments ensure that they have the money they need to be able to scale to meet these new behavior changes. Yeah. Now I'd like to pose a question to the audience, and we'd like you all to vote if you'd like to. So please, if we could get the poll up on the screen, what we'd like to ask is, what would be the most helpful for governments to do to help startups and tech companies amid COVID? So you'll have the next 10 seconds or so to answer this question on your screen. So do you think it would be most helpful for governments to offer small business loans, to offer cash for citizens, or to offer aid for large companies or bailouts? Please vote now, and we'll get to discuss this soon. So I know that what we've heard from some of our panelists is that people really believe that governments offering subsidies to pay for the salaries of these employees, rather than forcing companies to dig out of their own pockets, which may be significantly reduced right now, it has been very popular. And now, as we can see in the response to the poll, 81% of our respondents said that small business loans would be the best thing that governments could do to help these startup ecosystem. Maybe we could ask the panelists, why do you think that that's such an effective method? You know, we've seen that giving cash directly to citizens can help stimulate consumer spending and also help with just general hardship, but small business loans are critical for these companies to be able to bridge the short gap until they're able to resume revenue. Have you guys seen these strategies working well in your local governments and local areas? Vignesh, maybe you can tell us about how that's working in Singapore.
Yeah, sure. You know, so in Singapore, the government kind of gave a scheme to all approved investment partners, all financial institutions who have been already pre-approved for years to do either debt, where they kind of do one-to-one matching, kind of a debt, where if you put in $1 million, the government gives you $1 million, or equity type financing. And this new scheme works, but truth be told, it's always in tandem or in partnership together with a private institution. So let it be a bank, a financial institution, let it be a VC, etc. Because they are in a way dependent also on the due diligence and everything that VC does, right? So in that way, and they do that matching. So I think one of the key takeaways here, at least the question before and this one, is I think that is the government is there to support and really aid all these startups in the next 3 months. It's almost like a stopgap to allow them to kind of recover. But it is on the startups themselves to once again look for external a bunch of funding to do a bridge round to make sure you at least extend for 18 to 24 months, etc. So as much as the public market sector would help, the private sector still needs to be the main one taking the lead, and especially the startups themselves.
Great. So that really brings us to our big second question, which we'll be able to get a little bit deeper into this, which is, what are the best strategies that you've seen for founders on restructuring and fundraising in order to keep their companies alive? Now, one of the strategies that we've seen that's been very effective that comes from Rahul Vohra, who's the founder of Superhuman, an email client and a very popular startup in Silicon Valley. His strategy is that startups should pick a certain timeline of how long they want to have runway for, typically between 24 and 48 months, and then cut their burn rate by laying off employees as necessary in order to have that runway. But then each quarter or even each month, to adjust headcount in order to maintain that same runway. So if you decide that you wanna have 2 years of runway, you should have 2 years of runway now, but also in a quarter from now and 2 quarters from now, and maintaining that by consistently reducing your headcount. That way, even if you're not able to get funding for a long period of time and you have to consistently whittle down the size of your company, you'll at least be able to survive. And I think that that's a really smart strategy because it means that you don't have to depend on funding coming in at some certain period of time. And it's not about saying some certain dollar amount that you want to keep in the bank. It really is about how much you're burning and being able to sustain that burn for as long as possible. And remember, some companies might say, oh, well, we'll be fine with just 24 months of runway. But that means that in a year, you're going to have to cut your burn rate in half, which would be a massive cut, laying off maybe 50% of your company. So instead, if you can build towards a 48 months of runway, then you each quarter or each year, you'll only have to reduce your headcount slightly, and it'll be a lot less jarring to your business. Now, I'd love to ask some of the panelists, what have been the best solutions that you've seen for addressing headcount and burn rate for startups? Martin, maybe you could start us off.
Okay, I don't believe in what your concept is at all. There is no formula that one size fits all. If so, we would all go on Sand Hill Road and give the answer. I've seen C players beat A and B players because they got to market first, had a solution, and they're knocking the competition out. I don't know if any of you remember the movie The Highlander. There can only be one, and there's only going to be one winner. This year, we have closed down 11 unicorns already. Okay, these are $800 million investments, billion-dollar investments. So the key is, yes, watch your runway. That's what I said before. Reduce your burn. But be very sensitive. Once you get a client, don't try to do 20 other things. Understand what you've given that client, what the solution is, and then build your platform to get more clients similar. Too many companies try to do too many things and be everything to everyone. That's not going to work.
That's a great insight. So rather than trying to branch out into new business areas right now or trying to claim new types of clients, double down on the product that you've already built and try to expand your client or customer base so that you don't have to build new things. You can just sort of maintain the product that you currently have.
Correct.
Does anyone else have thoughts on great strategies? Maybe Viknesh or Thomas, please.
So I just can say from a government perspective, what we see in the investment sector is that there are four groups of startups. And I absolutely agree to Martin that there's not one size fits all solution. And the first group are these startups that it's hard to say, but it's the truth. There are startups that are going to die because maybe their business model was weak before and now there comes Corona. And so this means the end for them. The second group that we are seeing are the winners and the stars. So we have a German company that's called HelloFresh. They are delivering cooking boxes at homes. They have a very, very successful run and they overtook a lot of large industrial players in Germany when it comes to market capitalization. So the third group are the startups that have a problem for a temporary time. And therefore, we addressed with our helping programs to get through this crisis. Nobody exactly knows how long this will last. But as we can see in our country, so we are opening up quite a lot these days. And we're hopefully that maybe in July and in August, there will be the recovery phase starting. And the fourth group are startups also maybe absolutely not affected by this crisis because they still have runway and they are developing some kind of tech and so they're not on the market today and they have enough runway to develop their products until they're ready. And so these four groups, I think they need individual solutions. There's not a solution for everybody.
Absolutely.
Yep. So just to add on to this, I think the question was on strategies some of these startups can use. So I'm with the part on cost cutting. I'm with the part on 24 to 48 months, whatsoever, in terms of cash flow. But I think one of the key things here is to create very tight reporting metrics. and be incredibly nimble month on month. So one thing which works with us internally is now that we reassessed everyone's base best case situation and a normal, in a worst case situation kind of a thing in terms of three different business plans per company, we try to make sure that they do not deviate their net burn by more than 10 to 20%. If it does, we try to redo the business plan. So it's to be incredibly nimble. I'm not too sure about doubling down on your product and gaining market share. Again, we have seen, for example, in Indonesia, we backed one of the biggest B2B commerce startups there. But what they did was, even though trade has slowed down, all of that stuff has happened, they started looking at what else can they do with their existing infrastructure. So they started distributing COVID test kits. They started looking at how they can do PCR labs and all of that stuff, because they are the largest direct-to-business platform out there in Indonesia. So I think one of the additional points is to swiftly adapt, repurpose, and strive if it's possible.
I think that's really good advice, because it's true that if you try to cut your burn rate significantly and just sort of go into stasis until the end of this crisis, you may find that another startup who is able to raise money can outperform you and get to market or steal customers before you're really able. And that's why it's really important for startups to be thinking about how they can continue to raise money even in the middle of this crisis. As you guys have seen, there is money still available for startups. It's just they want to be backing wartime CEOs. So this is very different than a peacetime CEO who might be able to see the greatest opportunities long-term for their product. Instead, we need, rather than visionaries, we need people who are in the trenches and able to make the really tough decisions and be realists or even skeptics about what the future holds for them and say, how can we keep our burn rate as low as possible? How can we build for the resources that we have right now and build something that keeps us alive rather than maybe hits the greatest opportunity down the line. Now I'd like to bring a question in from the audience, and this one is directed to Martin. So Niels Christian Gonderup, he asks, what is your view on valuations in the US versus Europe? You know, valuations have been much higher in the US historically, and has COVID-19 brought valuations in the US down closer to the EU levels, or has it affected all of those companies around the world relatively, so the kind of the stronger valuations in the US remain?
Okay, so again, I don't believe in valuations. I'm in deals where the valuations are $1 billion and we'll wind up selling them for $10 million. Okay, it's really about, do you have a business? The valuation is great when you raise money. It's super when you do something where you're gonna go public. But you gotta go to your base of what you have. Is it a real business? Do you serve your customers? Do you give value? So I understand valuations probably as well as anyone in the world. They're totally, in my mind, in running your business, useless until you have a business.
That's great advice. So typically valuations of startups are really based on this long-term expectation of what they could be, but many of these startups may never reach that far-flung future given the crisis. And so it's much more about what their businesses can produce today, what kind of revenue they can drive so that they can be the masters of their own destiny and hopefully get to profitability so they're not reliant on other sources for funding. And so I'd like to bring us to our third topic. And this is I want to ask a little bit about specific to your home region. What do you see as the biggest challenge and the biggest opportunity facing startups in the next few years? So for example, His Excellency, would you like to begin?
Yeah, so I think, look, the short term is there are a lot of known unknowns and unknown unknowns. And we talked about this previously, Josh, right, in terms of what's happening over the short term, right? And I think that I'm going to try to answer that in a roundabout way here. But a lot of the times with startups, and the reason it's so attractive for governments to look to help startups, because the innovation, the R&D that comes out of that. And I look at the platforms that we have in Abu Dhabi, for example, with Hub71 and ADGM and the incentives that they offer. And I think one critical point, and we've touched on this in this conversation briefly, is that a lot of the time, the discussion around startups is how disruptive they are or how constructively disruptive that they're going to be. And they talk about how startups will come in and they'll help larger institutions be able to pivot, be able to become more agile. And I think this is a really critical point that if a startup has the ability to come in and help a large institution become agile, they need to look at how it is that they can become agile through this experience that they're going through right now, that everybody's facing right now. Now, if I look at it as it relates to the local market here, again, because it's still relatively nascent and what it is that we're building is just picking up momentum, all the financial incentives and everything that's been discussed here, we've had some very attractive non-financial and financial incentives in place for startups going back to last year. And I think what it's done is it's just highlighted the fact that when startups start facing a lot of issues and they're looking for that capital, we want to be selective in terms of how it is that we're able to come in and help those startups succeed. So we want to offer them as much financial incentive as we can, non-financial incentives in terms of helping them pivot, helping them reassess their business models, putting them in touch with the private sector, who will then help them address some of the issues that they have. And I think sometimes the conversation really starts to become about, well, look, I just need money for the next 6 weeks, and then we'll reassess my business. And I don't think that's the approach that startups should have. They should be looking at, to everyone's point here, do I have enough runway to last me through at least the summer, right? And if I don't, can I address some of the issues that I'm facing internally as a platform, as a startup? Or do I need to just go out, you know, shut up shop and look at something else? I think that's where post-COVID, right, post this issue that we're having, the conversation is not going to be how much money did you raise? The conversation with all these startups and the founders is going to be, what did you do to make sure that your business survived through the situation that we went through? And those entrepreneurs are going to be the ones that people will back, that people will push, because they were able to save their business by addressing the fundamentals within their business, right? So I haven't really answered your question as it relates to the local situation, but I wanted to highlight that because our conversations with startups tend to eventually revolve around these core points, right? And so we've got the financial incentives, we've got the non-financial incentives, we're pushing very hard to support the startup community. We just want to make sure that they also look at this and not say, okay, there's money available, I'll address my core issues later.
Absolutely. Yeah. I think a lot of startups historically have been sort of lauded for raising more money rather than lauded for saving money or efficiently using it. And I think what we'll see is that there's going to be a shift in who investors are seeking to back right now, mm-hmm. from founders who have great vision and might be have wonderful product sense and can see really long term about what opportunities they have. And instead, they're going to be looking for founders with grit, that ability to stay alive no matter what. And even if that means making really tough decisions, some of the truly empathetic, you know, warm and soft founders who might have been great at recruiting talent, those might be the ones that have the biggest struggles laying off that talent. And those companies who've made those moves early, you know, we saw some startups in America making cuts as early as very early February, saying, hey, if we just wait for two more months, that's just two more months of all of this runway that we don't have. And so it's so much better to make those decisive moves early and cut deep so that you can instead say, okay, here's the new state of our business and this is what we're going to do moving forward, rather than constantly having to add in new types of cuts, new types of cost reductions, which really hurt the morale and the momentum of a company. And it makes it difficult for clients and customers, especially in the enterprise companies, to say, oh, this is a company that's going to be around for a while, if they're constantly having to make massive business changes, rather than making one big decisive change at the start and saying, now we're prepared for the future.
That's the key, is too many changes in a company kill the morale and you lose direction and support of your investors.
I think there are quite a lot of opportunity. I mean, so we've been talking a lot about government and our role, but so far we've really only been talking about funding schemes and money. The truth is that we also have an immense responsibility as regulators. Like, we're talking about the startups that are doing really well. It so happens that those are the startups that are in heavily regulated industries, health tech, biotech, remote work, ed tech. And this is really the time for, you know, as a government, to really speed up some of the really outdated regulation that's preventing our companies from expanding and growing as quickly as they should, which is something that's been a massive priority for us. There's another thing that we haven't spoken about, government. Okay, in France, you're talking about every single hospital, every single school, everybody in the army. We're also a massive client And so it's also part of our responsibility to make sure that we can be a great client to startups and not just people that are handing out checks. So reforming anything that has to do with public procurement is something that's been a priority for us as well. And on top of that, I guess, you know, we're just talking about surviving, but it's true, a lot of people aren't going to make it. And there's also an opportunity to think about what's going to happen next and what are we going to do with all of the companies that won't, you know, that won't have enough runway, that whose companies just didn't make any sense. And we can't, like, as early as now, we have to think about them and what's going to happen next. Downsizing and the kind of measures that are important to be able to do that, the kind of financial measures that are, that allow that sort of transition as well. Taking care of like swaths of unemployed people that are also the people who will actually become the future motor of the economy. And let's not forget that really the economy is about people. So I think these are opportunities that we have now. Instead of thinking about just surviving, we already have to think about building what's next.
Absolutely. And I think what you're also going to see is that there are new opportunities for company formation right now. We've seen in the past that after recessions, sometimes there are the best companies formed. And this is in large part because of talent fragmentation. When it's really easy to build and fund startups, what you end up with is everybody separates and builds their own company. And it becomes difficult to get enough really brilliant people in the same room to be able to come up with expansive new products and things that can really change the world. And you see companies like PayPal that came out of previous recessions, where suddenly there were so many people that could have been their own CEO at a different time and have all gone on to become CEOs of huge companies. But because of that recession, they were all in the same room and they built a company as iconic as PayPal. And meanwhile, we're seeing incredible opportunities for hiring. You know, with so many of these companies having to do deep, deep cuts. Looking at companies like Uber and Lyft and other companies that have laid off 20-30%+ of their company, that means they are losing incredible talent, not because of the performance of that talent, but just because of the crisis that they're faced with and a cash shortage. And that means that new startups that are looking to get amazing executives across all disciplines, from engineering and design to product management and marketing, can pick up incredible talent right now at maybe even reduced costs and build companies that can really last into the future. Thomas?
Yeah. So, Josh, I would agree to that. And that's what we're seeing in Germany right now. I believe if you look at the startup ecosystem that we have, it emerged a lot over the years. But in the end, finally, you have to say we have a very successful industry. Look at all the car industry, machine industry, up to Airbus, very successful building planes. And so that's a huge successful industry, and that leads to the point that a lot of young people prefer to go to BMW or Airbus or whatever instead of building their own business. And I think there is a huge opportunity right now. And we also see that Germans get more and more familiar with digital technologies, for instance, this video conferencing tools or other things. And I think there is a huge opportunity. I agree to Kat that one thing we have to do is to open up regulation. One example for that was the regulation for driving customers by buses. And we were the first ones to open that up in Europe. And in the end, it resulted Flixbus and Flixmobility, which is a kind of a global platform champion that we have. And so we are working on opening up more and more regulations. This is one instance, and the other instance is a different field is the question how to enable startups to get offerings by the government. And now we're buying a lot of stuff, and we try to buy more and more from startup ecosystem. And the third thing we're doing is to establish more venture capital in the end. For getting really, really, really big. And if you look at the seed phase or at phase A, I guess there is a lot of money in the market in Germany, but we are investing, I already said in the beginning, 8 billion euros plus 2 billion euros right now for this Corona Help program. This is 10, and we are heading for additional 10 billion euros to make co-investments. So we invite everybody also here in this conference to invest in Germany, establish a fund in Germany, and we go into as an LP with a 20-25-30% so that you can extend the volume that you're investing, because we also want to see Googles and Facebooks coming from Europe and from Germany, and therefore we need larger rounds and more money for that, and we are willing to get into that.
Speaking of investing in new divisions and new types of startups, I want to bring up another poll, and I'd love all of the attendees to weigh in on this. Besides biotech and remote work startups, what are the sectors that do you think are going to grow the fastest due to COVID? So if we could please get that poll number two on the screen. We're asking again, you know, obviously biotech and remote work startups are doing very well right now, but what other sector do you think will grow the fastest due to COVID? Gaming, e-commerce, social networks, or developer platforms? And you guys have about 10 seconds right now to weigh in on this. One area that I don't mention here that is often lumped in with the rest of the biohealth and biotech startups is mental health telemedicine. I think this is going to be an area that will explode in the near term because we are facing a massive mental health crisis resultant from this crisis. People are actually stuck inside. There's a new sense of angst and helplessness in the world, and a lot of them are cut off from people that are normally part of their support network. And so I think that that will be an incredible area for innovation. And we've seen lots of interesting new startups like Koa and Torch offering everything from therapy to executive coaching to help people get through this crisis. So looking at the responses here, it was a little bit, there was some interest in gaming, social networks, and developer platforms, but overwhelmingly our audience thinks that e-commerce will be one of the fastest growing areas coming out of COVID. And we've already seen massive increases. You know, some startups are seeing holiday level interest or even higher already just in a normal midweek. And so I'd love to hear what, from the rest of our panelists, what do you think are some of the areas that will be especially benefit especially from this crisis, as tragic as it may be? What do you think about the e-commerce sector, but also what are some other areas you think will be benefit that maybe our participants should think about starting companies in or investing in? Vignesh?
Hey, thanks, Josh. So e-commerce is really wide, right? So I think more than e-commerce, it should be really what is the services, the essential services or product which is eventually being delivered to people. So if in Southeast Asia, and I think this generally around the world, I think there's emergence of direct consumer products, right? So this could be agri-tech, which is very, very interesting. I think you are starting to have almost community-led efforts in Indonesia, for example, or farm to table, all of this kind of stuff. So I think direct to consumer stuff is getting really, really interesting. You know, people would think naturally logistics is going to be making a lot of money, but truth be told, majority of the tech startups in Southeast Asia are still negative gross profit margin on logistics. Everybody's still losing money from Grab to Gojek on some of this delivery stuff. So we think edutech is a really interesting space. I think agri-tech is a very interesting space. Any other essential services products which is direct to consumers is really, really interesting now as well for us. Yeah.
His Excellency?
So I think that I agree with Vignesh. I think that one thing, so we've really looked at AgTech, right? And I think that there's this now with the situation many countries are facing and the uncertainty, there was, okay, well, what can we produce locally, right? And how can we use technology to help facilitate that production and make it more efficient and make it more effective? And I think that's going to be a core critical area of focus. But equally, I think one of the areas that should be looked at, and there are a few companies that are doing this and starting to grow quite quickly, is the waste component, right? How to be more efficient within that production, but also getting it to the consumer. I mean, if you look at the amount of food, just in food that is wasted, right? So we talk a lot about agritech, and I believe that we can accomplish amazing things by adopting technology in the agricultural space. But if you look at the per ton, per human waste that is occurring today, if you start addressing some of those issues, I think you're going to start helping all the other segments be able to work more effectively, going back to e-commerce, going back to delivery, going back to food. All of these, and these all feed into national security agendas for many, many countries in terms of how do we make sure we've got enough for our people and our residents. And so I think that's going to be a core area that needs to be focused on more.
You know, I agree with that, but we're looking, we also save companies too. Some VCs do bring us in early, and we're seeing personal services, things that help people. Right now, we're almost back to the 50s where the milkman's going to come back. Delivery's coming. Food services are coming with portion control, where instead of going to the grocery store and buying everything, concierge services we're seeing are going to be very big. So I think what's going on now is we're getting back where the human species can be a troubadour. They can go play more music because we're going to accept more delivery services of everything, like an Amazon or food services or whatever. So I agree with that, but I think is definitely going to be delivery, concierge services, taking care of our basic needs, so everyone is basically helping each other.
Absolutely. I think that, you know, we talked a little bit about biotech, and in that space is obviously benefiting as everyone is racing to build vaccines and new health products. But I think that telehealth in general is going to see a massive opportunity right now. In the US, we've seen a massive deregulation where suddenly doctors are able to operate across state lines, and that's creating lots of opportunities for startups. So, you know, that includes fertility and health issues, like companies like Roe, which is an e-pharmacy. Form Health, which is doing weight loss management remotely where you get a tele-assessment with a doctor over the phone, and Bicycle Health, which is helping with opioid dependency and other types of addiction. And you know, those kind of health issues that often people are actually quite embarrassed to go into a doctor's office and receive treatment, or go to a therapist, or go to a weight loss specialist, can be really daunting and very inconvenient. And a lot of these things, it really comes down to willpower. And I think one of the greatest opportunities of tech, whether it's in delivery services and in telehealth, is reducing just the amount of willpower it takes to have good habits. You know, if you get a salad delivery, you don't have to waste the time to bake a salad yourself and say, oh, I'd rather just order a sandwich or make something unhealthy. You eat the right thing. And similarly, it's like if you have to drive to a doctor's office just to get therapy around weight loss, you might say, well, I'm just going to go to McDonald's instead. And instead, being able to actually get that health and those health benefits coming to you, I think we're going to see that maybe COVID is this triggering moment when suddenly the world becomes so much more comfortable with telehealth that there's an explosion in all of these different areas, weight loss, addiction dependency, and food delivery, and many of these other places where suddenly people, it's a lot easier to get healthy instead of it being something that's a real chore. Thomas, what do you think about some of those areas that you think are going to benefit?
Yeah, I think that's obvious that they are benefiting very much. Everything that comes to delivery, e-commerce, communication systems. So, but I think this is working right now. And so, if you're not prepared to that, it's maybe too late to establish something new on that. But if we're talking about the startups that are going to be created right now, or they're at the very beginning phase, I would look more into deep tech. And this is something where we invest or co-invest a lot. And there are also strengths in our country. For instance, the whole thing about distributed layer technology, blockchain. I think Berlin's a very, very hot spot for DLT technologies. And so we're investing there furthermore. IoT is a large thing, sensor technologies for all the things like autonomous driving or whatever. A further thing is new space. We are investing very much. We are now the biggest investor in Europe when it comes to space, and we're establishing startups that build smaller rockets. So there is a lot of sectors in deep tech where it's interesting to invest. And nevertheless, I believe, so as the situation is moving right now, it's moving pretty fast. Maybe we see recovery more earlier than we were afraid of some weeks ago. And then also other topics are coming back, like mobility, for instance, and new mobility, and what can we do to protect the climate. And I think the ones that are engaging in this field, they will come back in the second half of this year, I'm pretty sure.
So I'd like to open up another poll, our final poll for the evening and for the session, and ask a little bit about when people think the startups are going to be able to start hiring again at their pre-COVID rates. And so if we could get that last poll up on the screen. And you know, a lot of companies are trying to think about raising money so that they can survive for 24 or 36 months without raising more money. But when do you think it will be that most startups are hiring at their pre-COVID rates? Do you think it'll be in as short as 4 months, more like 12 months, 24 months, or even longer to 36 months plus? We'd love to hear your perspectives on this. You know, I've definitely heard that it really will depend, and obviously this is going to be very dependent on what kind of startup. If you're one of these startups in the spaces we just discussed, which may be benefiting from behavior changes related to COVID, you may be able to hire sooner, or you may be even increasing hiring right now. But my real question is, what are the normal bread and butter startups? When are they going to get back on their feet? And we see that the audience is pretty optimistic. 11% thought it was as short as 4 months. Only 5% thought it would be 36 months plus. 25% thought it would be 24 months. But the overwhelming majority, 60%, said it would be in 12 months that startups would be back on their feet hiring at their pre-COVID levels. I think that that may be a little bit optimistic. And I'd love to hear what everyone on the panel's perspective is on this. I think that, you know, a lot of these companies, there are jobs that will not be coming back. There are behavior changes that will be permanent. And so while I think that eventually you'll see new startups being able to address these behavior changes, existing startups that were not originally made for this, unless they're able to significantly pivot to address these new behaviors, I don't think they will be returning to their same pre-COVID hiring levels, even in 36 months in some cases. I think they just may never return to that level. Martin, I know that you've seen a lot of this and are dealing with this a lot directly, so maybe you could weigh in on this.
Okay, so here's what we're seeing. I was just the keynote speaker at the Smithsonian. In order to be a winner, okay, you have to be in an anomaly. An anomaly is a non-replicatable event, and you need to be disruptive. But what we're seeing is, and again, I did see it. I was in the center of the fallout of the dot-coms. This is a great change. Everything that we have known in the past is changing. We will be possibly wearing masks the rest of our lives, okay? We have to just learn that it's going to take time. We don't know if it's 36 months, 48 months, or whatever. Okay, today, as all of us know, it's less expensive to invest in a startup than it was 20 years ago. You're using the cloud, you're using many other facilities. So I don't think we're even, and I agree with you, it's way past 36 months till we foolishly do something. We are going to remember this disruptive event for the rest of our lives. History will be talking about it forever. 2020 will never be forgotten.
Your Excellency, what do you think?
Yeah, so I think we need to go back to putting these into two separate buckets, right? The startups that are thriving and the startups that are surviving, right? And I think that when you look at those two buckets, and it doesn't mean that they're mutually exclusive, right? But there are startups today where their business models have become much more relevant. And the point I want to make is that there is capital available today for startups. In many ways, there are a lot of people in the private sector. You look at large conglomerates, you look at family businesses that realize some of their operations have been lagging behind or suffering because they haven't adopted technology. They haven't pivoted their business models. They're now looking for options. And I can speak about this from a regional perspective here in the region. So there is capital available. There are people that are spending money on startups that are investing, that are looking to support them. I think it all comes back to figuring out which of those two buckets they fit in and how it is that it can help over the, how the investors can help over the long term, and whether or not the founders are reasonable enough to understand that they've got to make adjustments to their business plan to be relevant in the long term. And I have to keep emphasizing that, because too often the conversation is, and I go back to what I said earlier, just provide me with some capital to get through the next couple months, right? But that doesn't address the long term fundamental issues that they may be facing as a startup. And our role as government is to enable that. We have to make sure that we're there to provide them with the assistance, to provide them with support, to make sure they can get through this period, but to not set them up for failure in 6 months, right? So we need to be there to help them through that. And that's what we're trying to do.
So we have some amazing participants here in the audience, ranging from New York to Nigeria, from Denmark to Mumbai, and you know, such great diversity here in the Jitex Future Stars community. And that's why I want to ask the panelists for some suggestions of startups and products that they hope to see startups building in the next few months and as we recover from this crisis, that could help us, whether that's embracing new behavior changes or addressing the crisis directly. So I'd love to ask, could some of you give us some ideas of things that you'd like to see people build as we move into this next phase, as we recover from COVID? Vignesh?
Yeah, I'd like to bring upon this this message His Excellency kind of mentioned a little bit earlier. It is, I think the question a lot of people are going to ask these startups after all of this, you know, there's some form of normality here, is what did you do during this period of time to recover from it? Let it be extending a runway, let it be honing your unit economics, making it better, let it be you pivoting to something else. So there's a variety of different things you can do. What we want to see is to make sure these guys are still, startups should behave like startups. They should be nimble, unlike large enterprises. They should be nimble, they should be quick, they should cut costs fast. They should be able to raise equity quick, find other alternative products, etc. So just be nimble and be a startup, right? So that is one of those things we are looking for. Another thing is Southeast Asia is unique to the rest of the world. I think over the past 5 years, you've seen investments go from $1 billion in 2015 to $12.5 billion last year in terms of investments into tech startups itself. So people should also be willing to do down rounds, bridge rounds, any of this stuff at that particular point of time, because you've seen a herd mentality and the momentum of startups and valuations going up like that in Indonesia and Vietnam. So I think there's a bunch of stuff you'd like to see at the end of this whole thing, but most importantly, for them to be quick and innovative. Yeah.
I know that some products that I'd really like to see specifically is focused on making mental health more accessible so that it feels like it's a little bit less daunting. I think group therapy apps especially are going to be very popular because it's a very sort of different experience to go into one-on-one therapy sessions. It's also very expensive and may not be accessible to everybody, but it offering this sort of gateway to therapy, I think, is going to be really important. And if you can do that at scale via video, it obviously is never going to be as good as being able to do this in person. But I do hope that more startups emerge to address the mental health crisis that is sure to stem from people being stuck in isolation, people having angst about their helplessness in the world. And so I think that's a great area for people to be building startups in right now. So I'd like to move into some audience Q&A because we have some really amazing questions from the audience. So Tushar Thakkar, he asks, for startups who have developed post-COVID products and solutions, how can they get in front of investors and raise funding during this lockdown situation? So I know that, for instance, one program that started in Silicon Valley is called Fundraise from Home. And this is allowing founders to actually submit a selfie video just from their phone, giving a quick description of their business. That's reviewed by a cadre of top seed investors. And if they like that, then those founders are invited to do a full pitch to about six of these top seed investors. And so they never have to necessarily meet anybody in person to be able to get wired money and keep their startup going. And I think what that means is that founders are going to have to learn not just how to pitch in person and really convey that passion, they'll have to learn how to do that over Zoom like we're doing right now, because that's really going to be the only way to be raising for the foreseeable future. And that means new types of pitch practice with your co-founders, new types of visuals that you can share, and just a new type of delivery that really conveys and makes emotionally resonant what problem your startup solves. Do you guys have any other ideas for how startups can be raising money during this time? Martin?
Family and friends are going to be very important in the beginning. Developing your product so that it really has a very defined purpose is going to be key. You know, the key I'm finding with a lot of entrepreneurs is they believe in their idea. It's okay to believe in yourself and your company, but before you believe in just your idea, check it out, go to conferences, talk to potential customers, really make sure you have filled every little gap and hole so that when your product is ready to get good investors in, it's a hot product.
So we have another question from Sachin Trivedi. He asks, will immigration policies in North America, Europe, and GCC change so that immigrants can contribute in the form of talent, investments, and technology? I personally think that yes, immigration policies will change, but they will likely be negative for immigration. It will likely be more restrictive as countries become a little bit fearful about people coming in from outside the country that might be exposed to the virus. The one interesting trend here is that we may see countries locking down travel from the United States rather than the other way around, which has been more traditional. And I think that that actually may provide some empathy to citizens of the US about what kind of discrimination many others around the world have faced for their entire lives. And hopefully that'll be a moment that will eventually lead to the countries and the world coming together more closely. What do you think all think of immigration policies and how they'll change in the next few years?
So France has a specific immigration policy when it comes to tech. We recently launched a sort of collection of visas, one is French Tech Visa, which is the most open tech talent visa in the world. Literally in France, you could, any startup can hire anyone from anywhere in the world, bring them to the country fast-tracked. From the US, for example, it takes like 9 days to process. They get a residence permit, which is valid for 4 years, immediately applicable to their families and renewable. Now, these are the sort of things that were happening pre-COVID. And I think these are the things that we need to look at as well, because there's obviously the sanitation component of immigration, but a lot of it also really just has to do with, you know, the general attitude that each country has regarding immigration and how they're looking at that. As far as I know, for France, the only constraints that we're going to be seeing in the future are the ones that have to do with health safety, but they have no bearing whatsoever on how France thinks about making sure that we can have really international companies that are being built from here with founders from all over. And I'm saying this as the person who leads the tech team of the French government, who isn't even French, which is something that, you know, France is, you know, when people think about France, I think it's always like a, you know, kind of awkward sometimes to sort of come up and be like, yes, I'm a French government representative, because obviously everyone has a stereotype on, you know, what a French government official looks like. And the truth is that France is changing. It's been opening up quite aggressively, I would have to say, when it comes to tech talent. And although we will be very careful, I don't see this changing how we feel about international talent.
So we have a question from Richard. I'm sorry, go ahead.
I want to add, because I think in Central Europe, the situation is quite similar to that. And right now, during the COVID crisis, it's nearly impossible to travel wherever, also in Europe. But we did a similar thing like France before COVID came. We started a new immigration law, and I right remember it started on February, something around. And we have a different strategy than the US immigration scheme, because in US there is a quota of people like physicians or chemistries. And so what we are doing, our mechanism is, if there is a company that wants to engage somebody from outside the European Union, and if you have a final contract, then you can come to Germany, and it works this way around. And it's also diploma agnostic, as the French system is. Right now, this is new for us. And so it's very important, as we also see there is a war of talents worldwide, and we try to get more attractive. And therefore, I guess, once we are through this corona thing, however, if you can say this at one point, I think we will open up quite more than we did in the past.
Maybe just one more thing on immigration. Something that we also have to think about are all the tech immigrants that are already there. The ones that can't go home, that can't leave, that, you know, whose families are very well established. And so that's something that we think about as well. Like, these people are already part of our ecosystem, and putting in place the kind of sort of soft landing and support services to make sure that them and their families are okay, and they're not getting their residence permits don't expire right in the middle of the crisis and wind up in a very difficult place.
Yeah, I want to say I agree with Kat. I think that you look at who's already on the ground and how it is that you can help make sure that the experience and what it is that they might be going through right now is managed. And I just want to highlight, so we've always had a very, very easy immigration structure here in the UAE in terms of labor being able to move in and out of the UAE. And I want to go back to highlighting that talent and that need for innovation and R&D, which I think all the panelists here are focusing on, right? We have to keep pushing that. We have to keep pushing the boundary to make sure that startups are given the right platform to be able to expand and develop new companies, sectors, you know, and improve the ecosystem. And all that is going to rely on the movement of talent across borders. And I think we're looking at that very seriously from how it is that we can support those innovators that want to come and be based here and how it is that we can offer them. I think the UAE government a while back introduced new visa categories for people to come and move here and have favorable environments. So I second what Kat and Thomas were talking about in terms of making sure that this works. And again, I want to highlight that the funding for this, for innovators, for people that are driving that technology shift, is available. And I can say this, and I'm not trying to speak on behalf of anyone on this panel, but you look at the programs that exist elsewhere as well, the funding is available. And funding is available relatively quickly, depending on your model and what it is that you're trying to accomplish, right? So I typically see a lot of entrepreneurs that will say, well, look, we're here, we're trying to do something. I'm like, yeah, but if you're not picking up traction anywhere, you might need to reassess your business model and figure out why it is it might be taking you so long to raise capital. I mean, we have lots of founders that come in and it's a very quick turnaround process in terms of what is it we invest. And there are others where we want them to show that eagerness to be able to pivot, right? So, but again, there is a massive focus on talent, I think, everywhere. And I hope that the experience that we're going through today globally brings us all back together, right? Social distancing, I hope that social distancing leads us to becoming much closer on a global scale in terms of how it is that we help one another.
Absolutely. So we'll take one final question from the audience. Richard Binier asks, do you see that the Asian economies will be the first ones to recover? And would you advise startups to look at these markets to make revenue sooner than trying to focus on other geographies, like perhaps the US? Vignesh?
Yeah. So with regards to the Asian economies, so let's just talk about it really quickly, right? So generally, every Asian economy is foreseeing 2020 to have a lower GDP growth rate in terms of, if you're talking about one country to another, the impact varies. So Thailand, for example, is going to be one of the hardest hit because almost 25% of the GDP is travel and hospitality. You know, it's just tourists coming in, etc. So they are massively hit. But if you look at Vietnam, for example, they're the first out of the gate here. They are almost back to some kind of normality. The past 2 years have been great for Vietnam, and we foresee Vietnam probably not taking 36 months to go to normality. I think it could be even quicker, right? So I think Vietnam would be quick. Singapore, as usual, is one of the strongest legal and financial ecosystems. So technically, as much of growth happens in the rest of the Southeast Asian region, Singapore is always just gonna be benefiting from that some way or another. But there is generally a slowdown. I do think that some markets, rather than others, will recover faster in Southeast Asia, namely Vietnam, Singapore, because of the thorough amount of testing and what's happening there already. And I would say Philippines is starting to look really interesting as well in terms of growth. Indonesia, I think that's a big problem there right now. I think it's going to take a lot longer than expected for Indonesia to get back to any kind of normality. Yeah.
Great.
Maybe just a quick word also on international expansion, because we're seeing different trends. Like what we're seeing is a lot of startups kind of doubling down, going to their home base, you know, huddling with people from their country. But you're also seeing some other startups that are being really quick to change the playbook to adapt to a new normal. One advantage that we have right now is that since, you know, everyone is now fully okay with working remote and doing Zoom calls, then it reduces the need to be physically present, which is something that has always been, you know, a massive, you know, cost regarding international expansion. Another thing that we're seeing is that, you know, when a lot of companies you know, did massive layoffs, of course, one of the first people to go were all the sales teams. So you're actually looking at a market right now where you have some really top-notch you know, VPs in sales. Maybe you had the first wave now, and then when you do the second wave of layoffs comes later, you're going to start seeing them. What I'm hearing is that, you know, you're sort of taking almost like a 25% discount on what that talent normally costs. They're there, they're available, and this might also be a pretty, you know, innovative way to be able to go to market in a new place.
Great. So before I ask for some final remarks from our panelists, I'd like to just run through some of the amazing insights that they've brought us today. So when we discussed the government programs, you know, the audience really thought that small business loans have been the best performing, and the panelists believe that when the governments take over salary payments and take that weight off the shoulder of startups, that's what's really having the best positive impact. And for startup founders, they really need to be thinking about at least how to get enough money or cut burn enough to get through the summer, until revenue may start to resume, but truly you should be thinking about 24 to even 48 months of burn and how you can adjust your business plan and your headcount to be able to survive as long as necessary in case that funding doesn't come through. And that often means showing an eagerness to pivot, saying that we're not just going to take this flat-footed and be responsive, but we're going to proactively try to change the company to address these new opportunities and behavior changes. And this is going to be an event that we will remember forever, and some startups may never start hiring at their same rates. But if you learn how to pitch over Zoom, if you go to friends and family and seek investment, you may be able to get the runway that you need for the meantime. And if you institute tight reporting metrics and are agile on month-to-month adjustments, you'll be able to weather the storm no matter how long it lasts. Because valuations really aren't real right now. It's about what your business can do in the present and the amount of revenue you can generate to keep yourself alive. And that's why right now, founders need less vision and more grit. They need the ability to make tough decisions, decisive, deep cuts that will allow them to stabilize their businesses and get back to helping their customers do what they do best. And instead of trying to branch out into new product types, doubling down on what they're already doing well and expanding their customer base in that space. And there are massive new opportunities because of all these behavior changes, agriculture tech and changing to food waste, fixing e-commerce tools and delivery startups, as well as personal services for everything from mental health to weight loss. And so now before we conclude, I'd like to let each panelist leave you with some final insights. And so we'll go in reverse order. So Viknesh, would you like to start us off with just some parting thoughts?
Sure. I'm pretty sure the rest of the panelists would touch on, cutting loss quick, et cetera. But one thing which has always been, ringing for everybody is disruptive technologies and being disruptive and all of that stuff. In Southeast Asia, I don't necessarily think disruptive is the right word sometimes. It could be market creation. With this time, which has happened, it's unforeseen, there could be an opportunity to be innovative, create a whole new market for everybody. So it is about being innovative, nimble, stay as a startup, do quick moves so that you sustain and get through this period. Yeah.
Thank you. Martin, do you have some parting words for us?
We probably see more failure than anywhere in the world, sadly, but that's our business. And so when we talk to the entrepreneur, we've discovered a couple of things. One, less is more. Focus is best. Having an idea of where your end game is going to be. You can change direction, but if you don't know where you're heading and understand what you're selling to your customer and the need of your customer, you're just not going to be successful. You can't wiggle all over the ocean not knowing where you're going to get the food. So focus, less is more. Be decisive and don't overextend yourself. If you don't need something, don't get it until you really are desperate.
Great, thank you for that. Kat, would you give us some parting words?
Yeah, sure. Like maybe this is a message for those who are the hardest hit and who are gonna have to close shop not too long from now. I hope this panel has convinced you that, that the crisis hasn't shaken anyone's belief in the future of tech entrepreneurship, and that you will get up and just sort of put yourself out there. There are a lot of tough problems. There are even tougher ones right now. Anything from the health crisis to global warming, and these tough problems need tough companies and even tougher founders to just go and launch them. So please get right back out there.
Great. And Thomas, any final thoughts?
Yes. I think we see a lot of challenges these days, but we also see a lot of huge opportunities. And when I talk to the investment veterans, they are saying that the strongest companies came out of the crisis, the dot-com crisis in 2000, and the next ones on the financial crisis in 2008. And so maybe this time is kind of a filter for the companies that have really an impact and really a good business model. And therefore, I can invite you, if you're going with your business model, or if you're looking for a good place, I can invite you to come to Germany. We have a lot of co-investment we're doing. I think we have a very, very good skilled workers here and engineers, and you're all very welcome. We would like to see a lot of you, and especially if you're heading into deep tech, I guess we also have a lot of corporate companies, tech corporate companies from the industry that can partner with you. And so I would like to welcome some of you in Germany.
Thank you so much for that. And finally, His Excellency, I would really love to hear a little bit deeper of a final parting words, because I think you're such an inspirational figure. And I think that your leadership is especially important in this moment of crisis. And I know people are looking for someone to give them some feeling that there is light at the end of this tunnel. So maybe you could just give us some of those parting words.
Thank you, Josh. That's very kind of you. I suppose the first thing I want to say is that I feel very privileged to have listened to Thomas and Viknesh, Martin, Kat, yourself, Josh. And I think that we are forever on a learning curve, right? And we have to maintain that. We have to make sure that we're learning both as individuals, but then as institutions. And I think what's really important for us is to make sure that we're constantly receiving that feedback from the active players in the economies, in the cities that we live in the countries that we're based in. And I think that that's the only way that we're going to be able to maintain the momentum that we're building. It's the only way that we're going to be able to help companies and individuals that are looking to create the next big idea and really kind of set themselves apart. And I think it's the only way that we're going to be able to really come together universally. And I'm not trying to sound cliche here. I'm not trying to turn this into a kumbaya session here. But I do think that every one of these individuals, all these panelists, a lot of the comments that I've been reading that have been coming through, you can see that there's an eagerness to get through this and get through this together. And I think that the more it is that we can link together and make sure that we build something, and you know, look, I want to feed off what Thomas is doing with his team. I want to talk to Viknesh. I want to find out what Martin's doing. You know, I want Kat to come in and say, look, why can't we do these things together, right? And I think that for me is the biggest takeaway on this, is that there is support. There are institutions, governments, and investors that want to make sure that everybody is growing in the right way, and we've got to work on that together. And so sorry that if I may not have tackled your question directly, but I just wanted to get that out, because I do think it's important that we focus on the fact that we will get out of this, and when we get out of this together, we're all going to be better for it. Thank you.
Thank you for that message of hope. And thank you all from Paris to Arizona, from Saudi Arabia to India, across every time zone, for coming, participating, and being part of the JITEX Future Stars community. You know, the world needs the agility and innovation of startups more than ever to develop the products that will speed up the world's recovery from this crisis. And from online commerce tools to telemedicine, there are opportunities to learn more about this. So please be sure to tune in to future JITEX Future Stars online sessions, and we'll all be excited to see you live later this year. You know, this pandemic threatens to pull different nations and people further apart, but I believe that you, the global startup community, can ensure that this is a moment where the world stands in solidarity for a better tomorrow. So Ramadan Kareem, and best of luck to you all and to your loved ones. Thank you so much for joining the JITEX Future Stars community today.